What's up, everyone? This is Ryan Eckert with Peak Endurance Solutions, and you're listening to the VO2 Max podcast. What's up, everyone, and welcome back to another episode. Today's episode is going to be just a slight deviation from the sort of topics that I normally talk about. It's just going to be myself today, but rather than talk about the science discussing or the science surrounding a particular topic like I have done in past episodes, this one's going to be slightly different. It's not going to be focused on a particular topic within endurance sport. It's something that can be applied to not only endurance sport, but also just to other aspects of life and business and things like that. But it's a topic that I often find myself talking to with other athletes in particular on a somewhat regular basis. It's a pretty foundational concept when it comes to things such as like statistics and epidemiology and research in general. And it's this concept that correlation or association does not equal causation. And it might sound, when you're hearing it for the first time, like it's going to be something that doesn't really apply to you because it's related to research or statistics. But it's something that is incredibly applicable to endurance sport in general, and especially for those of us that do things like triathlon, cycling, running, swimming. And it's a trap that I often find a lot of athletes and even sometimes some coaches falling into is noticing a correlation or an association in their training or their racing, and then immediately assuming that because there's a link between two variables, that one variable caused the outcome that they were looking at. And that's not necessarily always the case, and it's sometimes a very dangerous trap to fall into. And I'll give some examples here in a second that's going to help illuminate those points or bring some more light to those points for you to help make it a little bit more applicable to things that might happen in the real world. But I wanted to start with one example that I actually first learned of when I took an epidemiology course back when I was in undergrad at Arizona State University. And I was in an epidemiology course, and it was probably, this is probably one of the first topics that we learned about, so it was probably within the first few weeks of the course. The professor at the time brought up an example to help illustrate the point that correlation doesn't always equal causation. And there was a pretty famous example of this back in, I can't remember the exact decade, but it was probably sometime in the 50s or 60s. But there was some research that was coming out in which there was a link made between coffee consumption and pancreatic cancer. It's kind of interesting because you wouldn't necessarily think that coffee would lead to an increased risk of pancreatic cancer. And in general, we know nowadays that coffee in small amounts is actually, it can potentially carry with it some health benefits. And so it was kind of surprising to see that an increase in coffee consumption was associated with an increased risk of pancreatic cancer. But to highlight the point that correlation doesn't always equal causation, so these two variables were just related to each other, right? In this particular case, and in this type of research, it was mainly gathered via like retrospective, which is like looking backwards in time, kind of survey data, or like cross-sectional data, which is where you take a bunch of people and you get like a snapshot of one point in time. And a lot of this data was coming from those types of research studies, and it was just a correlation that was found, right? So there was no study that was done in which they like made people drink coffee and then they assessed how many people got pancreatic cancer, you know, months and years down the line. And so all this data was gathered from just like survey feedback, essentially, from participants, either at like one point in time or like retrospectively going back and asking people about their coffee consumption and then looking at the rates of pancreatic cancer. So there's an association there that was linked between the coffee consumption and the pancreatic cancer. But what researchers ended up finding was those who drank more coffee were more likely to smoke, or vice versa. Those who smoked were more likely to drink coffee. And that's where the actual causative link is between smoking and pancreatic cancer. So we do know that the more you smoke, the more likely you are to develop pancreatic cancer, or the higher your risk is. So it just so happens that those who smoke tend to also drink more coffee. And so what the coffee consumption is known as is a confounding variable. So it's this like third variable that's floating around that might look like it's related to the outcome of interest, which in this particular case was the risk of pancreatic cancer. But that third variable is really associated with the smoking, which in this case was the causative variable. And so therefore it's known as a confounding variable. So something that almost might confuse you when you look at the relationship, because you might think, oh, well, coffee consumption is related to pancreatic cancer, but it's not really. It's just related to smoking. So those who smoke just tend to drink more coffee. But we know that the real relationship lies between smoking and pancreatic cancer. And so this is obviously an example that isn't relevant to endurance sport, and it might seem like an extreme example because we're talking about smoking and pancreatic cancer in this case. But in the world of endurance sport, it happens all the time. All the time. I mean, you can go on social media and look at athletes that claim that their performance improvements are due to supplements or materials of clothing that they're wearing or some other random thing that they started doing in their training or in their diet. And they'll make claims that their performance improvements that they saw or their progress over the years has been entirely due to like this one thing or these two things. And coaches will sometimes do it too. And I've fallen into that trap too. You know, I look for patterns in training where I look for things that are associated with improved performances of late. And sometimes I'll notice correlations and associations, and sometimes my mind will want to jump to the conclusion that, oh, it must be because this one thing was changed that their performance improved, or that they saw better times in their training session, or they're getting faster, things of that nature. And so it happens all the time. And I'll give you an example here that's relevant to endurance sport that I see quite commonly so that it'll help maybe give you a more practical example for endurance sport. But imagine we have an athlete, and let's just say they're a triathlete, and they're trying to set a personal best in an Ironman. And they've been competing for a few years, and within the past few months, they started taking this supplement throughout the day. And this supplement was marketed to improve their performance, right? Let's just make it a blanket statement, a very general statement that supplement was aiming at improving their performance in general. And they made these claims that it was going to improve their endurance and all these other aspects surrounding endurance performance. And so the athlete started taking it. And then the athlete goes out a few months later and they set a personal best in their Ironman. Now, a lot of athletes might look at that situation and focus solely on this one supplement that they started taking and say, well, it must be the supplement, right? Like I must have seen improvements in my performance because I all of a sudden started taking this supplement. And you know, the supplement told me that it was gonna improve my performance, and it did because I saw an improved Ironman time. Now, this is just an association, right? Like there's no way of proving that one thing caused the improved performance, especially because there's so many other variables in training to account for. It would be really difficult to make the claim that supplement was the sole source of that improved Ironman performance. Now, obviously, we can do research studies in which we control for all those factors, and we have someone make one specific change, and then we follow up with them, you know, a month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, however long it is, later down the road and assess whether or not their performance changed. But the problem we often run into in the real world is that there's so many variables. There's all these different things we're doing when it comes to recovery. So things such as our diet, how much we're sleeping, other recovery modalities that we're implementing into our week-to-week routine. And then there's everything that's going on with our training. So our training that we've been doing accumulates over weeks and months and years and leads to us getting better and faster and stronger and fitter. And so my point is that there's just so many variables to account for that oftentimes what I see a lot of athletes doing is they'll try and pinpoint one tiny little thing that was associated with a period of time in which they experienced some type of improvement in their fitness or their race times. And they'll sometimes attribute it to one specific thing. And the other problem with this potentially too is that they'll oftentimes try and attribute it to certain like products or pieces of equipment that we know might not necessarily have that much of an impact on their overall performance. It might be like one of those kind of 1% improvement kind of things that they implement into their routine. But a lot of athletes will sometimes like latch on to that one thing that they changed that they knew of. And they'll make that connection between that thing that they changed, which you know could be like a supplement, or they started using a different piece of equipment, or they started using like recovery boots, whatever it was. And they'll make that leap to assume that that was the cause of some kind of like drastic improvement in their performance. And so that's just one potential example in the realm of endurance sport in which some athletes or coaches might make the leap that a correlation equals causation, which oftentimes it doesn't. So that's the problem with looking at correlations and assuming that a correlation is the same as causation. Is that oftentimes it's not. And while it's not necessarily like a dangerous thing to assume that, like it might be in more high risk fields like medicine, or in like the previous example when the correlation between coffee consumption and pancreatic cancer was noticed, that's obviously a more high risk, dangerous scenario or example when compared to endurance sport, when we might be like looking at the correlation between recovery boots and improved running performance times. Like obviously there's really no danger in making that correlation. The only problem is that it could be potentially misguided and it could lead a lot of athletes and coaches to focus their time, energy, and attention on a specific variable that isn't necessarily the real reason behind their improved performance. And so one of the main reasons I wanted to record this episode was to help get across the point that yes, not only does sometimes associations and correlations not necessarily mean causation, but a lot of times what happens is athletes will get hyper-focused on these really, really small, tiny, somewhat insignificant variables in their training, things like dietary supplements. And yes, like there is there could be a good reason to take dietary supplements or utilize like recovery boots or other recovery modalities, but those types of things, those small changes in your week to week routine are going to be, they're going to account for very insignificant proportions of someone's performance improvement. So like taking, you know, there are certain supplements out there that will market themselves as like trying to improve your performance when in reality they may or may not do anything. But if they do, it's going to be so small and insignificant that it isn't going to be the primary driver behind improvements in performance. And I can think of some specific examples and names of products, but I won't name them here. But the same goes for other things too, like articles of clothing, like compression garments, and recovery products and things like that. But athletes will oftentimes get fixated on that and it takes their attention away from the bigger picture, which is the consistency and the quality of their training and how much they're sleeping, which is like the most important predictor of recovery, how their overall diet is in general. And like the 95% of the things that make up seeing consistent improvement in performance over time. So that's where the like quote unquote danger comes in with correlation equaling causation and a lot of athletes and coaches looking for these really tiny minute details that they've tweaked or changed and then noticing that relationship between that one variable and a period of time in which they saw some type of improvement. And then latching on to that one small thing and thinking that that's the sole cause of their improved performance. That's where the danger lies, is that it takes their focus away from the bigger picture, the bigger things that we know for sure are probably the main driving force behind improved performance over time. And when it comes to improving performance over time, there's really no secret, there's no special product, there's no supplement, there's no piece of equipment, there's no recovery tool, there's no product out there that's gonna have a drastic effect on your performance. The main, if I could simplify it into a few different areas or buckets and categories in which influence your performance to the greatest extent, it would be just the consistency and the quality of your training in general over time. As long as you're consistently training, like day in, day out, week in, week out, month in, month out, and you have good quality training, you're gonna see improvement over time. And then the second area or category would be diet. And this doesn't necessarily mean prescribing to a specific diet, it just means like the quality of your nutrition overall. And as long as you're eating like a well-balanced, well-rounded diet, you're eating consistently throughout the day, you're fueling around workouts, you're fueling during workouts, as long as you're accomplishing those major tasks within your day-to-day nutrition, that will help support the training that you're doing and it will help you recover from the training that you're doing. And then the third big area would be recovery, but most of recovery is comprised of diet and sleep. So in this category or bucket, I would pretty much term recovery just sleep, since I already touched on diet. So it's really the training, the nutrition, and then your sleep that you're getting, because sleep is where the majority of your recovery takes place. And so if you're not sleeping, you're not recovering adequately, and therefore you're not going to see the same results over time that you would if you were sleeping really well. So those like three things are like the main driving forces behind improved performance. All the other things that we do, all the other little pieces of equipment we use, all the extra supplements that we might take, all the pieces of clothing that we use to help us recover, like compression garments and things like that, those are all like little one percenters. They're things that might have a very small impact on your performance. And when done consistently over time, yes, they might yield a noticeable difference, but it's going to be a small difference. It's not like using recovery boots is going to improve your running performance by like 10%. Like, it's just not going to happen. What's going to improve your running performance by 10% over time is consistent, high quality training, eating just a well-rounded diet, and fueling yourself appropriately, and then getting enough sleep each night. And so that's really where the danger lies in with correlation and causation. And it's the trap that a lot of athletes and coaches I've noticed tend to fall into, is looking for these correlations and associations and then attributing improvements in their performance to these variables that we know aren't necessarily the cause of drastic improvements in performance that athletes might notice from time to time. So again, that's really what this whole podcast episode was focused around, was just kind of discussing that point or that topic surrounding correlation and causation. And the main takeaway from this is to, first of all, just know that when you're looking at variables or factors that are related to like an outcome or an improved performance, what you're looking at is an association or a correlation. And just be careful not to get too caught up in attributing that correlation as being causative, right? So don't look at one variable and automatically assume that it caused the improved performance or the faster times or the personal best. Just always revert back to the big picture, which is high quality, consistent training, well-rounded nutrition and fueling throughout the day, and then getting enough good quality sleep at night. That's the big picture. That's where 95% of your improvement over time is coming from. The other 5% are those small, tiny variables that we can manipulate. But that's much less significant than the big picture, which is the training, the nutrition, and the sleep. And so just don't get too caught up in some of those smaller details and some of those smaller correlations. And yes, while some of those things might make a minor difference in your training quality or your performance, it's best to focus on the big picture first, especially if the big picture is lacking in any way. Like if you're not training consistently, but you're taking all these supplements and you're using all these random recovery modalities and pieces of equipment and tools, everything that you're doing with the supplementation and with the recovery tools isn't really going to help you out if your training quality and consistency isn't there. Same could be said if you're training really consistently and you're training really, really hard, but you're not getting enough sleep, or you're not eating very well or fueling yourself appropriately throughout the day. The improvements you see over time are going to suffer because of that. So take a step back and looking at the big picture, making sure that you're training consistently and with good quality over time, fueling yourself appropriately, and then getting enough sleep. If you're doing those things, then that's where you can start to dive deeper and look at some of those other smaller, more minute things that you might be doing on a day-to-day basis and how those things are starting to impact performance. But then also just be careful not getting too caught up in looking for associations and labeling them as being causations. And that's really the main take home from this podcast. So hopefully you enjoyed this episode and got something out of it. And hopefully it kind of shifts the way you analyze or approach looking at and critiquing your training and your performance over time. As always, you can reach out to me through my website or via email, and I'll be sure to link those two forms of contact into the show notes below. And yeah, just let me know if you have any questions on this or if you want to have a more in-depth discussion of this, and I'll be more than happy to have that conversation or answer those questions. Until next time, cheers.
Thank you for tuning in to today's episode. If you're listening to us on iTunes and you have a free moment, go ahead and leave us a review. Those reviews are very much appreciated. And if you know of anyone who would be interested in following along to our podcast, please be sure to share this episode with them and let them know to subscribe.